If the Zongshen RX3 were a food, it might be a curious delicacy. Have you ever eaten balut, which is a duck fetus? Or kivyuk, which is a bird stuffed in a seal fermented over several months? What about a sheep's head or a buffalo testicle? To many, these meals seem extremely unappetizing, but to others, they're beloved, delicious delicacies. See, nobody would be offended if I said I didn't want to eat balut, but people will be offended by my review of the RX3. So if you already own and love the RX3, then stop the video right here and continue loving it. Take it out for a ride, forget what I or anybody else thinks, and enjoy your awesome motorcycle and its many great features. If it puts a smile on your face, then job well done. I've always said that it's not the bike you ride, but where it takes you that's important. It's your definition and personal taste for adventure and fun and pleasure. However, there has to be a line drawn when it comes to the adventure and dual sport classification. While a rider may have a genuine adventure on a Yamaha R1 or a moped or something like that, marketing those as perfect adventure motorcycles would be dishonest when compared with offerings from KTM or Honda, Kawasaki, Suzuki, or BMW, and so forth. So, while to me, there's a lot of gray area between the adventure motorcycle and dual sport classes and what actually quantifies an adventure, there are clearly bikes that don't really belong in either class because they're not really meant to go off-road. And to me, the RX3 is one of them. It's an okay road bike, but for an overlanding option, it might be a bit of a stretch to call it an adventure tourer or dual sport. Now, I hate reviewing anything badly, but my job is to do honest reviews for my audience, save you money and heartache, and recommend quality adventure gear on a budget. Since my audience funds the channel, dishonesty only harms me. I bought this bike because my patrons voted for it and wanted to see a brutally honest review on a bike they were curious about. Now, I know full well that a negative review can and will hurt relationships with future sponsors, make a segment of the community angry with me, and hurt resale when I auction the bike off for charity. So, even if you're offended that I'm about to criticize a relatively obscure, totally niche, inanimate object, know this review very literally hurts me more than it hurts you. And I'll be honest, I want to love it. How awesome would it be if this were the poor man's Africa Twin, but for less than half the price? I want groundbreaking bikes to come out and push the market, to give Kawasaki and Suzuki and Honda a reason to upgrade their old designs. So like Balut, I'm sure the RX3 is very appealing to some, but it's certainly not going to be for everyone, and it's not going to change the adventure market just yet. So on to the details. For weight and ability references, I'm about 200 pounds with all of my gear on, 5'10", and consider myself about average skill on both street and dirt. It should be noted that I love dual sport off-roading, and I am reviewing this bike as it's marketed, as a machine that functions both on and off-road. And I'll be comparing it to other motorcycles in the dual sport and adventure touring genre. That's only fair. So, let's start on a good note. If there was a checklist of things that should be on every single adventure motorcycle, the RX3 checks pretty much all the boxes. It's got fuel injection, inverted forks, crash guards, an electric start, lockable panniers and a top box, an adjustable rear shock, a skid plate, a windscreen, auxiliary pigtails under the seat with on-off controls on the handlebar, an instrument cluster with a fuel gauge, gear selector, a clock, and other useful indicators, 75 mile per hour speed, a sixth gear, a fairly big fuel tank, passenger pegs, a nice wide bucket seat, a low center of gravity, and a low seat height. So it looks really good on paper with all those bells and whistles, especially for about 4,000 bucks. Borrowing looks from the F800 GS, it looks really good in pictures too. But after getting all giddy about its looks and features and price, I rode it over 1,000 miles in 3 different states and quickly realized that even though the boxes are checked on paper, that does not translate to the actual experience of riding the bike. So let's go over the boxes in detail. First, the fuel injection. Other reviews have stated that this bike has very linear power, and it does. But my first impression while riding the bike was, let me demonstrate with a drag race against a 2007 Toyota Prius, driven by my wife with my kids in the back.
3, 2, 1, go!
We ran this race 5 times with similar results, and my wife is not the Stig. So it's slower than a Prius. Its top speed is an indicated 83, but a verified 74. That's not a cruising speed, that's maximum speed. That means it takes everything this bike's got to ride 6 miles per hour under the Utah highway speed limit. So we've seen that it's not great at accelerating, but how does it do it slowing down? It's a little under 400 pounds, which is KLR 650 territory. And while it feels lighter in most cases due to the lower center of gravity, it feels heavier when braking. The front brakes are just not very effective, and the rear brake helps, but locks up off-road a little too easily. The forks are inverted, but 5 inches of travel is not enough to soak up anything really gnarly, even if they had work done to them. Stock, they're like a pogo stick, and make it difficult to maintain a line in tough terrain. On fire roads and easy gravel, paired with the stock tires, the bike feels much less planted than other dual sports. On ride after ride, dirt and gravel roads always felt too sketchy for me to ride with confidence. Leaning the bike under you and weighing the outside like you would on a normal dual sport washed out more than once on me, and when it does wash out, it's very sudden and, for an average rider like me, happened too quickly to recover just one too many times. Knobby tires would help some, but remember, traction is a marriage of suspension and tire contact. Even the best DOT knobbies won't be great because the suspension won't keep them on the ground. After riding it, my friend Paul painfully stated that with suspension like this, the RX3 should be sold with a cup. On the road, the rear shock does that slow bottom-out thing that compresses your spine and even mellow dips. In whoops, ruts, or G-outs, it's not pleasant or functional. I hate to say this, but I've ridden thousands of miles off-road on many different off-road bikes, and I've never ridden a bike that loses control so suddenly and catastrophically. So much so that I don't really feel this bike is safe for off-road use. I pushed this bike less than I push my other bikes, and that kind of stress seemed too much for the rims to handle. I ended up with a huge bend in the rim, and a replacement cost $200. Adding to that, the rims are matte black and have a texture to them, so unless you really scrub them, they're going to look greasy and brown after just about any ride you take. The crash guards look quite sturdy, but on the first 15 mile per hour low side in powder-covered gravel, the crash bar bent into the right side radiator, and the bolts holding the guard to the frame popped straight through, and needed big washers to bolt back on. They worked to prevent a lot more damage, but these are certainly not premium engine guards. Using U-bolts doesn't seem very well thought out either. The panniers look like premium panniers and have been likened to Pelican cases, but they are basically Tupperware painted black, and even then I feel a little cheated with the space in the right side pannier. The first slow low side, and despite the guard, the right pannier was already cracked. They aren't easily removed from the bike, the locks are a bit finicky, and the top box lock was defective from the factory. The readout on the RX3 is actually very nice, with several features that should be standard on every bike. However, the indicators in the cluster are far too dim to be useful. The fuel gauge is about as accurate as a politician under oath, telling you you're empty at about 2 gallons left. The speedometer is also off by about 10%, indicating 75 when actual speed is 67. The gear indicator is nice and shifting is very smooth all the way up to a much needed 6th, but it struggled to shift from first to neutral standing still, and sometimes pops in and out of gear on difficult terrain, which stalls the bike or kills very much needed momentum. It has passenger pegs and a pillion, and the passenger pad on the top box is a nice touch. But weirdly, it's got this big sticker that says not to have a passenger, and it's got a weight limit that would exclude any adult passengers as well. Completely ignoring the sticker, I jumped on with Jeff from Colorado Dual Sport to see exactly why they warn against this kind of thing. As for looks, once again, I absolutely love it. It's quite photogenic, aside from the speed sticker on the side that might be more at home on a 1990s Barbie big wheel. And while it hasn't happened much to mine, many loyal CSC owners have lamented the paint job that chips far too easily and colors fade with only a year of ownership. It's not really geared low enough to handle off-road hills without a lot of clutch slipping. Most on-off-road bikes have a granny gear or a fairly low first gear to handle crawling speeds for good torque and traction going up a hill. With the RX3, you rev it to 6,000, feather it, burn it, die, and repeat. I've had a few comments in my dirt test saying not to lug the bike, but with so little power and tall gearing like this, you're either going to burn the clutch or lug it until it stalls. There is no tractor factor. Granted, it's still quite fun on this steep, rocky torture test, the same way that golfing would be fun with, like, a pool noodle. It's an entirely inappropriate tool for the job, but it still can technically do the job in most cases. And while it won't be winning any tournaments, it still provides some goofy fun. Going back to the clutch, while shifting is really smooth, the clutch lever feels like there's too long of a gap between that initial grab and full engagement. This really gets frustrating when coupled with low power, low torque, and tall gearing up rocky hills. I have to say though, it earned a lot of respect from me, simply for not utterly falling apart while on some of these trails. But what about falling apart? Past Chinese motorcycles have a reputation for doing just that. Well, I did push this bike pretty hard, and asked it to do things that many owners may never do. That being said, I pushed it less than I pushed my KLR, or DRZ, or WR, or the XT I reviewed. And after pushing it as much as I dared, I doubt it could stand up to that kind of abuse for much longer. The bolts start coming out, and the panniers wobble now. The body panels wiggle around and pull away from each other, and everything scratches a little too easily. The pleather on the seat seems paper thin, and it was torn under normal riding conditions. The exhaust nearly fell off, and accessing the bolts to get it back on was a total chore. Again, the rear rim bent quite noticeably from my normal riding style, and, well, it might look like a quality build, but after 1,000 miles of pretty rough riding, even though it's survived for the most part, I just get nervous that it's not going to hold up much longer. For comfort, the seat's ergonomics look like the wide, comfortable saddles on larger adventure bikes. And while that was a positive thing for larger riders who took it for a spin, for me it was deceptively uncomfortable. The bars get quite vibey at highway speeds, and the whole experience made me and the other test riders uncomfortably numb. The crash guards hit my knees, which is a safety concern and another reason not to take it off-road, and at a medium height I found it awkward to stand, and you'll most likely want to be standing with the suspension, even on mellow fire roads. However, the pegs are bigger and nicer than most stock pegs, which is nice. So yes, the boxes are all checked, but like I've said in the past, there is so much more to a motorcycle than bullet lists and spreadsheet figures. And on that vein, it should be pointed out that even though the bike has its fair share of issues and its stock upgrades may be more about marketing and cosmetics than true function, I still have had fun riding it. It still put a smile on my face between 7 and 9,000 RPMs, and it still got me to some beautiful places. It gets about 65 miles per gallon. The skid plate does its job. The windscreen is surprisingly good at highway speeds. The auxiliary power cables with the switch on the bar are a great addition, and the sixth gear serves its purpose well. The headlight does a fair job casting down the road. The low seat height is good for shorter riders and makes going up rough terrain really quite easy to waddle, especially with that low center of gravity. The bike also feels well balanced, and I rarely struggle to keep it upright. The same can't be said for other top-heavy dual sports. So, on to engine reliability. And who can really say on this bike? Zongshen claims they build 1 million motorcycles per year, and looking around China roads on Google Street View, I believe them. There are rumors out there that Honda uses Zongshen-built small engines in their own products. Now this bike is only a year old, so while people can vouch for mileage, nobody can vouch for overall longevity. The build quality on the RX3 seems pretty solid at first glance, but if you plan to ride it off-road, I just don't think it will last. Another concern, when I did the break-in oil change, the left side oil screen cover had damaged threads from the factory. Like any new bike, only time will tell how truly reliable the RX3s are. And that is the big thing, isn't it? Time. The main concern from skeptics is the availability of stock parts long-term. Whether the engine is bulletproof or not, if for some reason CSC can no longer import parts that wear out on any bike, like a sprocket, and there is no aftermarket support, will your RX3 be unfixable? CSC is stuck in a paradox. It needs to sell enough bikes to make long-term parts distribution possible, but it's hard to sell a lot of bikes when buyers aren't completely convinced they'll be able to get parts long-term. Now, I haven't personally dealt with customer support from CSC, but other RX3 owners rave about quick responses, fast shipping, and quick handling of any warranty claims. The online wrenching tutorials are quite easy to follow with good pictures and really well-done instructions. CSC seems to be a stand-up company. They know what they're selling and seem reasonably honest about what it is while still marketing its strengths. And they really work hard to make sure any potential issues are addressed before the problem ever starts. CSC's website has a section where they tell you what bolts to keep an eye and some Loctite on, and are pretty upfront with common issues. However, I wish they would just handle that for you out of the factory. So CSC's marketing, while the 6,200-mile Eastern European Rally, the Baja, and a 5,000-mile road trip are all impressive, those aren't round-the-world trips, so they might be a little overzealous when they say this is the perfect bike for around the block or around the world. But still, other motorcycle companies might learn a thing or two from California scooter companies' rock-solid service. So who might this bike be a good fit for? Mid-range road commuters who want good gas mileage, built-in light-duty luggage, a low seat height, controllable handling, and very predictable power on a good-looking machine that may or may not last a very long time. And now for the brutality. If you're looking to do any off-roading on a true dual sport or adventure tourer, in almost every case, your money would be better spent on something else. Every other dual sport I've tried has been far better in almost every way, and many can be had for thousands of dollars less used, and some only a grand more brand new. What's more is that every one of my riding friends who test the bike both on and off-road came to the same conclusions that I did.
This is a commuter bike. This bike is made for you to hop on in the morning, ride to work, and ride home. That's about the extent of what I can see this bike being used for. Should it be being marketed to the dual sport or ADV community? Not a flipping chance. It's not that bike. I mean, here's the suspension. That's it. I'm bottoming it out. And I'm sorry, Tyler.
Do I think they marketed this correctly as an adventure motorcycle? I do not. I mean, maybe they did as a light adventure motorcycle. If you're just the adventure rider that wants to take a motorcycle that is not a Harley, be able to do a little bit of dirt roads and pass roads that are paved and stuff like that, then yeah, I mean, it's like a diet adventure bike. It's like the light version.
There's no such thing as a cool looking scooter. Even when you're on a ruckus, people still know exactly what you look like when you're sitting on the toilet. Get this instead. So that's who I think this bike is for. People who were gonna get a scooter and don't wanna look stupid. If for every other kind of need that I can think of, I can also think of a better alternative that you'd be better off with, even used for $4,000.
So if you keep it on the road between 7 and 9,000 RPMs and don't mind its pretty big limitations, like Balut, maybe you'll fall in love with the RX3. In finality, the RX3 can be a fun bike and would make a decent commuter. As for being a game changer in the dual sport and ADV world, it's not, because the final opinion of everybody who I let ride it was the same. One, the features were nice on paper but underwhelming in reality. Two, it's too underpowered and uncomfortable to compete with adventure tourers, and too undersuspended and brittle to compete with dual sports. And three, the price is attractive, but budget-minded bikers can get a better bike used, mod it to their preference, and still come in near that price point. But there is a silver lining. What it is an early model year Kia or Hyundai, a newcomer with questionable reliability and a low price tag that gets from A to B. I really hope that, like Kia and Hyundai, Zongshen becomes a game changer, pushing Japanese and European innovation in the overland world. So while the RX3 is not a game changer right now, give it a few years and a few iterations, because with massive resources, solid service, and a unique marketing and distribution plan, both Zongshen and CSC have massive potential. Like all new model bikes, once they work out the kinks with the RX3, we may have some great things on the horizon. Thank you so much for watching, and if you enjoy potentially offensive yet brutally honest reviews on inanimate objects, please click the subscribe button. If you'd like to select the gear and motorcycles I buy, test, and review, then you too can support the channel and make these unbiased reviews possible on Patreon. Click the card or the annotation to find out more about that. And if you're looking for a dual sport with similar seat height, fuel injection, but more suspension travel, a granny gear, and proven reliability for only about $1,000 more brand new, check out my unbiased, unsponsored review of the Yamaha XT225 and XT250 by clicking the video in the upper right corner. If you're interested, I'll be auctioning this bike off shortly with a free 2-day private adventure ride in southern Utah, with all proceeds above $2,500 going to disaster relief and humanitarian aid both at home and abroad. Much love to all of you, ladies and gentle tubers. eveRide out.